When speaking about strategy, the first association of many people goes towards vision, mission, objectives and similar. And those same people usually assume that the job of a strategist stays within that realm, pretty much as a sort of a deliberate choice, separating strategy formation from its implementation, and thinkers from doers. In order to broaden that narrow and mostly wrong perspective, we have prepared for you a very comprehensive business case where we are going to walk you from setting strategic guidelines, through developing strategy details, till decomposing all those elements to the level of individual investment programs and projects. Originally, this material was prepared for our online course, Strategy Execution, Investments, Project Management and PMO, published at Udemy. And we are going to present it here as it is, just merging the three separate video lessons into one in order for you to have everything at one place. Enjoy, and if you need any clarification, you can find more details within the description. During the past few lessons, we have bombarded you with so many information, so you may become a bit confused what's this all about. Don't worry, let's connect the dots by walking you through a business case, from setting strategic guidelines towards gradually building the pipeline of individual investments or projects, or to say differently, let's structure your portfolio. Let's imagine you are a strategist in a relatively small, independent, vertically integrated oil company. In order to simplify it, let's imagine it's involved in exploration and production, refining and managing own sales channels as presented below. Some of the key challenges regarding exploration and production business arm refers to the following. Operating in the region relatively poor with oil reserves. As a consequence, the company is mainly supplied with external crude oil, currently targeting approximately 40% of production intended to satisfy it from its own existing reserves. And this is a declining trend since it's difficult to maintain current reserves available on a long run. Some of the key challenges regarding refining segment refers to the following. Although that's the only refinery in the country, large players from neighboring markets are increasing the market pressure. The refinery is far from the state of art, rather inefficient in terms of the percentage of light derivatives, while producing significant amount of low-margin products like fuel oils compared to other champions who are able to further refine it into more lucrative diesel products. That's related to installed technology. We can say refinery debt quality as well. Market is generally oversupplied with gasoline, while diesel is in a huge deficit. It could be sold in volumes of whatever you can produce. Refinery has a solid potential to increase its own capacity utilization. Yet, the main barrier refers to market opportunities to sell gasoline. You can't produce only diesel, rather a mixture of different derivatives like gasoline, diesel, jet, lubes, bitumen, etc. Some of the key challenges regarding sales channels refers to the following. The company is a national market leader targeting mass segment. It has a total network of approximately 350 fuel stations, out of which 300 focused on domestic market. With average throughput of 7 tons per day, network efficiency is lagging behind the players targeting premium segment. For example, the key competitors like international fuel station chains targeting premium segment are strong especially along the international highways and major cities, offering standardized large format stations, premium fuel quality and wide range of non-fuel products and services. Their network efficiency is in range of 15 to 20 tons per day of fuel sold per station, with highly profiled networks of only 30 to 50 stations. Further market expansion on domestic market is difficult due to already high market shares. Presence at neighboring countries is relatively weak, targeting regions close to national borders, not entire markets, preferably due to strong competition and logistics. In order to supply the market, company is forced to even buy diesel externally. On a long run, regulatory changes regarding ESG and electric vehicles represent a solid potential threat. Some of the key challenges regarding financial position refers to the following. Although it might seem as a great company at a glance, its assets heavy. For example, annual depreciation is 150 to 200 million euros, requiring a constant maintenance and cash outflows intended for capex instead dividends. Return on capital employed gravitates towards 5-6% per annum, putting a pressure on top management to do something about that and increase the performance. Shareholders are additionally concerned about increasing market competition driven by international players covering the entire region, not just our market. That level is fine. Based on those premises, top management team has defined the following strategic guidelines. Exploration and production. Maintain own crude oil production and replace the reserves as much as it is possible because it gives the company stability, resilience and better margins. Next, refining or refinery. Upgrade the refinery in order to maximize overall profitability through increased efficiency and better product mix. Next, sales channels. Improve overall efficiency of existing network, increase the volume sold throughout our own network and cement the leading position in domestic market. Increase the presence in the region. Next, financials. Increase overall profitability in terms of EBITDA and net profit, along with improved dividends to shareholders in the long run. As you can guess, it's too vague and in practice, it's always translated in numerical targets or guidelines like the following. Let's quickly clarify it before we start developing strategy details. When we speak about exploration and production, at the essence, that means we are probably going to slightly decrease annual crude oil production and reserves due to lack of appropriate reserves replacements. Most likely, it will require strong restructuring and optimization activities in terms of people needed, selling assets with low utilization rate, etc. Let's not further complicate it here. Next, refinery. As you can see, we are going to significantly increase production level based on imported crude oil and the utilization rates. It's based on the premises that we have made a breakthrough and secured channels to sell more fuels, especially gasoline. In addition, you can notice improved efficiency ratios, which is based on the refinery upgrade or modernization, meaning significant capex. Next, sales channels, or the key strategy enabling factor. As you can guess, we have to significantly reshape the network, both the domestic market and to expand it abroad. For example, if you would like to sell additional 100 to 150,000 tons of fuel per annum at domestic market without expanding the network, since we already operate 300 stations and have 40% of market share, that means we have to increase average sales on approximately 150 to 200 fuel stations for 2 tons per day each. That's up to few hundred new customers daily per station. It's a huge challenge without ruining the margins and basically impossible to achieve at rural areas. On top of that, you'll have to increase sales in the neighboring countries for 150 to 200,000 tons per annum. That will require to expand the network for additional 40 to 60 fuel stations if you can achieve 10 tons per day per station on average. Since the markets are already saturated, most likely you'll have to acquire some smaller, independent local players, not to build the network from scratch, meaning buying plots. If you pair this with increased targets for the wholesale, it's clear that you'll have to develop your own logistics as well, including storing capacities and maybe even means of transportation. You can say, okay, fine, I'll have a good budget for investments, meaning 1.5 to 2 billion euros. Well, yes and no. Over 1 billion euros will be spent on the refinery upgrades, related refinery logistics, and exploration and production business arm. That means your sales channel budget will be up to 500 million euros. Basically, the entire planet CAPEX is the most sensitive to the potential oil reserves findings. In addition, refinery upgrades will take you approximately 3 years to complete it, meaning you'll have to at least expand the network in that time horizon in order to secure sufficient sales capacities timely. Basically, most of the activities will have to happen in the next few years, while the remaining period will be focused on fine-tuning or additional performance improvements where needed, plus spending some money on regular maintenance. So, take some time and think how you would approach the challenge and develop relevant strategy details. Since this is a very complex task, we are going to focus all our efforts to explain in details aspects related to sales channels business arm. Later on, we are going to translate those strategy details into individual investments or projects, meaning building the pipeline or the intake. Let's look again at the targets and present our own potential solution. First of all, we should think how to answer the following key strategic questions, like how to position the network at domestic and neighboring markets for successful competition. What type of network or stations we should target in order to increase volumes, especially for gasoline, and overall profitability. How do we improve profitability of the current network? What is the best strategy for expansion in neighboring countries? And what are expected profitability levels and investment returns from the strategy? Let's start with the first one. How to position the network at domestic and neighboring markets for successful competition? Before we start answering it, let's talk a bit about current state and the best practices. A domestic market, the company is running a pretty much heterogeneous network, mostly targeting mass segment. In order to establish itself in neighboring countries, it's positioning between mass and premium segment, yet as a niche market player since it's focused only to nearby border areas. If you pay attention to any retail industry, like supermarket chains, clothes, etc., you can easily notice that national champions usually have a multi-brand strategy, targeting premium customers with one offer, mass market with another, and possibly economy segment with a third. It's the same in running fuel stations networks. Simply, it's much easier to communicate with separate targeted audiences this way. On the other hand, when going to other markets without a local refining base to support it, oil companies are usually focused at establishing a network targeting only premium segment, usually along international highways and major cities. And they usually reach a national coverage, not just staying focused on some small areas or market pockets or niches. For example, premium segment is characterized with large, well-formatted or standardized stations, premium fuel quality, and richer non-fuel offerings resulting in higher share of non-fuel sales in total revenues. In general, customers spend more time in this type of stations since they can drink a coffee, have a rest and similar. That's a clear contrast to the economy offer. Here, the customer is usually buying only a cheap fuel plus maybe grabbing some elementary non-fuel products and quickly keep moving forward. That's common for rural area and even smaller towns. So, if we would like to succeed on the market, we have to reposition ourselves. A domestic market, we have to enter the premium segment by reshaping or reformatting the best 50 to 60 stations, which is approximately top 20%, and possibly develop another brand name or visual identity for that. Other stations should stay targeting a mass segment, including the closure of the weakest sale points. On the other hand, we are going to reshape our operations at other markets by focusing entirely on the premium segment, using the same brand as we are going to establish for the domestic premium market segment. That way, we will be able to reach better recognition along the international highways and major cities where we can usually find people from the region traveling. As an alternative, we can keep operating under one brand at all the markets. Yet, in that case, we'll have to reformat existing stations, creating an easy recognition what we offer here versus there, meaning along the highways, large cities, most of the towns, or at rural areas. Differentiation and better visual identity are needed anyway to stand out and attract more traffic. Next question. What type of network or stations we should target in order to increase volumes, especially for gasoline, and overall profitability? This is another great question. Basically, the next step is defining our avatar or typical targeted fuel station within a network. It is related to the ideal customer question. For example, if you would like to attract truck drivers and individual business customers who travel a lot throughout the country, most likely those will be diesel-oriented drivers, even corporate clients focused on highways and other important national roads. Is this our real target? Although it is always market-specific, based on our own market research and company data, we came to the conclusion that in our case, we can set the following guidelines. Location. Larger city stations are usually the best channel for selling gasoline. The next best option refers to highway stations or larger stations along the major national roads. Throughputs. In general, we should exclude fuel stations with throughputs of less than 4 to 5 tons per day from our network, which is weakest 10%. Those fuel stations are generally not very attractive, ruin our goal of improving efficiency and brand awareness, and have very low non-fuel sales. Next, ideal customers. Individual clients, people who are not cost-driven, they are willing to spend more time and money at fuel stations. In general, people at bigger cities earn more compared to others, have a faster lifestyles, forcing them to do things in parallel, like buying fuels, eating, drinking, and resting at the same time. Product mix. On top of regular diesel and gasoline products, premium or high-quality branded fuels are also highly valued by targeted customers. Basically, fuel quality and location or proximity are the main drivers for the customers. Next, non-fuel offer. Cafe, convenience store, and wide range of products are needed, including fresh drinks and foods. At some locations, car wash option might be a great magnet for local customers. Wi-Fi is always a must-have, in some cases restaurants, etc. There is a clear correlation with fuel and non-fuel sales. With increasing fuel sale, non-fuel profits rise, and vice versa. Shop size. In range of 40 to 80 square meters, has the best performance in terms of capex and net profit. For sure, major competitors are aiming the same customers and locations, making it a real challenge. Yet, the good thing is that we already have a promising prospects or plots. We just have to make them more attractive from the perspective of offer or content and visual identity. Based on that, the next question. How do we improve profitability on the current network? Here is the point at domestic market, while neighboring markets are the subject of our next question. At domestic market, we can apply a wide range of activities like fuel station reconstruction while playing with the market repositioning, introducing brand fuels, non-fuel offering improvements, playing with working hours and optimal number of employees, network optimization in terms of number of stations, etc. So let's go and explain it one by one. Fuel station reconstruction. If you remember, we have a fuel station network of 300 stations. An economic station life is estimated to 15 years. That means we have to replace 20 fuel stations per year anyway. Usually that means we have to destroy existing facilities and rebuild the station entirely, including related properties like fuel tanks, fuel loading equipment, totems, etc. Since we are targeting 2030, it means we are talking about 6 to 7 years period, or 120 to 140 stations. And that's a lot. If we speed up the process a bit, we can add approximately 50 more stations, targeting more of those positioned at major cities and along the highways. Keep in mind that with a fuel station reconstruction, we usually achieve some volume increase because customers are attracted to new projects. So, basically, we can use this fuel station reconstruction process as a main vehicle to reshape and reformat the network as we wish. Basically, we're going to select the best 50 to 60 stations and format them to comply with premium segment requirements. We are going to upgrade other 100 plus stations in order to cement our mass market segment player position as well. Throughout this process, we can even introduce a new premium brand if we decide to do so. If we spend on average 2 million euros per station, depending on location and selected format or scale and applied equipment and inventory, that's a total budget of 3 to 350 million euros. If you succeed at improving the sales for 2 tons per day per station, just through these investments, you'll be able to sell additional approximately 100,000 tons of fuels per annum. Next, station light rebranding. In order to improve or align a new visual identity throughout the entire network, you'll have to spend some money on light rebranding, meaning changing lights and colors on windows, shelves, totems, etc. Maybe even to arrange park areas to be more suitable for kids, parking plots, and similar. That will cost you 50 to 100,000 euros per station, which is 5 to 10 million euros in total for the remaining of the network. Similar expenditures are already included within a budget for fuel stations that are subject of your reconstructions. If you succeed to increase the average sale for, say, 0.5 tons per day at these fuel stations, you can count for additional 20 to 30,000 tons of fuel per annum. Next, introducing branded fuels. This not assume some significant capex, rather opex and marketing activities in promoting it. Basically, you have to add some additives to your regular fuels in order to enhance the performance. Approximately 10 to 20% of sold fuels will be branded. A fraction of those will be additional volumes, mostly redistribution among the current customers. And the effects of the volumes are already calculated within just mentioned volumes increase within previous 2 points. Yet, you'll be able to increase margins and overall network profitability. Next, non-fuel offering improvements. Based on the analysis, you can always find products that do not sell properly, optimize them and create space for new, hopefully better ones. If you look what the best-in-class offer a day fuel stations, of course, depending on a format, space, available and location, most likely you'll notice a fresh food, lot of drinks, snacks and similar, including the space where customers can rest and enjoy the purchase before continue driving. Especially at fuel stations along the highways or nice city stations, you can expect a slightly higher prices. That's the potential for further margins increase. What's important to highlight, for some additional non-fuel offerings, you'll have to assume additional capex. For example, you'll need more fridges, shelves, tables, chairs, equipment for coffee preparation, probably to add TVs, etc. Since you'll cover most of those throughout reconstruction, you won't add all those offerings to all the stations, you will not have significant additional capex here, maybe 2 or 3 million euros max. Next, working hours and employee optimization. According to the market research, you have found out that fully automated stations are not interesting for your customers. They would like to be served. So, in order to slightly optimize the number of employees, the best you can do is to introduce self-serving coffee machines, apps to pay for the fuel, and similar in order to speed up the service. Here and there, you can also adjust working hours a bit. In total, that will help you to optimize OPEX to a certain extent and increase overall network profitability, yet it's not a game changer. Next, network optimization. Based on the company data analysis, you have identified 20 to 30 fuel stations to close since those are either the weakest performance, they are present in areas where you have a few more stations and now it makes more sense to invest in other 3 and close the 4th one and similar. Yet, you cannot count to earn on that since you don't want to let your direct competitors to take them over. For some, you'd be glad to, of course. In addition, you'll have demolished some of those and count on ESG-related costs because you are not legally allowed to just abandon a fuel station. On top of that, you are constantly eyeing for new opportunities. Cities are developing, new roads are built, so there is always a new opportunity here and there for a new fuel station, maybe one or two per annum. In total, you'll have to budget 20 to 30 million euros for those activities, meaning closure and new openings. To summarize, for domestic market, you'll have to expect at least 350 million euros, possibly even 400 million euros, for the purpose of improving profitability of the current network. Don't forget that you'll have to expect some additional investments for maintenance, especially logistics like storing capacities and transportation means, usually 5 to 10 million euros per annum. That will be additional capex of 30 to 50 million euros at least. When we speak about neighboring markets, or the question, what is the best strategy for expansion at neighboring countries, there is a similar set of activities that we have to take into consideration. Yet, the emphasis will be different. First of all, we'll have to expand the network for 40 to 60 new stations in order to capture additional 150 to 200,000 tons of fuel sales. Plus, thinking what to do with existing 50 stations. So, let's go and explain the initiatives one by one. Network expansion. Since we are eyeing 40 to 60 new stations in few countries, that's restricting us from looking for to acquire large players, rather to acquire few smaller independent chains since the markets are already saturated and it will be difficult to expand by acquiring plots and building stations from the scratch. Such activity will cost us at least 80 to 100 million euros depending on network quality, station condition, and especially if that includes a storing capacity that has to allow us to increase wholesale as well. Rebranding costs are included. Next, existing network repositioning. Our existing network is at the neighboring markets is in a good condition, and we should expect 5 to 10 million euros per annum for the maintenance capex, including periodic reconstructions, light rebranding, improving non-fuel offerings, etc. That's a total of 30 to 60 million euros. From strategy standpoint, it will be important to reconsider abandoning some of neighboring countries in case of good M&A opportunities emerging in other neighboring countries, so we will be able to make a swap and reach there a better market concentration. Of course, possibly paired with the planned storage acquisition, while keeping the total targeted number of stations. Next, other initiatives. In order to strengthen market position in neighboring countries, a sort of a partnership with existing independent players should be explored in more details. That's a common approach in fuel sales business. That's important from the wholesale perspective. They, meaning local partners, can operate under our or their own brand name, while we are going to supply them with our own fuels. To summarize neighboring markets strategy, network optimization and taking care for existing network will require additional 110 to 160 million euros for capex, preferably depending on a storing capacity. In total, domestic market, meaning 350 to 400 million euros for improvements, plus 30 to 50 million for a regular logistic maintenance, along with just mentioned 110 to 160 million euros for neighboring markets, accounts to 490 to 610 million euros. In practice, we can expect to exceed targeted budget of 500 million euros for sure. In order to secure sufficient money, we'll have to consider further capex optimization, along with finding opportunities for monetization from non-core assets, or something else that we can sell. For example, we have our own transportation means, trucks and railway wagons, so maybe we can sell them and buy a service instead. We can also think about selling rights for running convenience stores and or restaurants within our stations. Of course, those and similar initiatives will be explored in more details as alternative scenarios, since they are not part of the core operations, rather an add-on that can help us in achieving the main strategy. After all, you want your strategy to be approved, not to make enemies from guys running a network or logistics. They can take it personally, meaning you actually think someone external can do the job better than me, so you want to kick me out. Plus, it's not just a pure political move. You have to increase overall operations attractiveness if you would like to attract external partners to work with you. And for that, you need at least few years of synchronized work in upgrading the network and volumes. And meanwhile, a lot can happen and change. Working in iterations is fine, and you don't have to make all the decisions today. Finally, the question, what are expected profitability levels and investment returns from the strategy? As you can imagine, whenever we talk about strategy, strategic initiatives, investments or projects, there is a question. Is this profitable? Or what is my return on investments? Or should we pursue it this way? Especially in large companies, strategy work relies on intense financial modeling, meaning creating detailed Excel file to calculate financial indicators like PI, IRR, DPP and similar. If our strategy has sufficient indicators, we can get a green light for the execution. Since this course is all about project management from organizational standpoint, we are going to assume here that the strategy is approved as presented, and now let's focus on translating or packing those strategy details into individual investments and projects. And of course, as another strategist, you might have different preferences for sure, so let's see how you can incorporate them timely into the pipeline without launching an open war. Here, we are going to translate just mentioned strategy details into your individual investments or projects, or to structure the portfolio. In order to simplify it, we are going to stay focused entirely to the sales channel business arm. Based on the previous talk, as a mid-step, you can easily recognize few major investment programs within the portfolio. In this case, developing premium segmented domestic market, refining mass segment approach, taking care of other domestic maintenance, dealing with other markets and handling other initiatives, as summarized below. And of course, on top of those numbers, you'll distribute them over time and calculate the individual economic indicators. What we are going to do is to start implementing or defining a cost, schedule and scope elements within a portfolio. Yet, here is the point to look at the structure of each presented program and create a detailed pipeline of individual projects for the next year and estimate for the upcoming 2 to 3 years. So, let's decompose each program. When we speak about developing premium segmented domestic market, this program will consist of few major initiatives that we are going to further chunk into individual projects on a fuel station level, coming from the strategy details as presented below. Basically, the entire CapEx will go to reconstructing fuel stations and further network optimization, including finding new prospects. On the other hand, we haven't presented any CapEx for new brand development, branded fuels or non-fuel offer. These initiatives will in practice for sure assume some spending. The question is how we are going to manage that. If you recall from the beginning, project management activity is company specific and it depends on many factors, including project management maturity. In practice, here are some possibilities how to approach it or to resolve the potential issue. First, assets heavy industries. If you spend a lot of money per annum on CapEx, you might be tempted to exclude and control all the projects entirely focused on OpEx separately. For example, here we are talking about total investment portfolio of 1.5 to 2 billion euros intended for CapEx on a company level, while related marketing costs or OpEx for brands development are just a small fraction compared to that. In such cases, you can spend more time in preparing the overall marketing budget and controlling the spending with your colleagues from controlling department, while keeping those activities out of your investment pipeline at first. Of course, you'll use the planned spending numbers and allocate them accordingly when calculating individual projects and programs' economic indicators and during the post-investment monitoring. You'll even check when approving individual projects results of a market study related to the necessity for rebranding, what's the feedback of focus group regarding the visual identity, applied specific station layout, proposed new non-fuel products, etc. However, within your pipeline, in this case, only fuel station reconstruction and network optimization projects will be visible. Mentioned activities of your marketing team will be assumed as their regular operations or their duties when helping in your project's preparation and execution. Next, service-focused companies. As an opposite, you have more and more companies structured and run around the projects. Instead to be internally, they are rather externally focused or clients-centered. Just imagine an IT company offering programming services to the clients or a construction company working for numerous real estate developers. They have to record working hours and all other expenses and investments, so later on, that will be used for charging for the service. Simply said, case with oil industry is not perfectly suitable for those types of companies, although in many aspects, the nature of the process is the same, yet instead of individual investments, there will be clients as a central reference point. Finally, dual approach. In some cases, companies can combine approaches in order to better check all the cash inflows and outflows. As you can guess, our case is investment-centered, just like the entire course, so the projects and spending will be decomposed to fuel station granularity level wherever suitable. Simply, those will be projects run by individual project managers later on. In this case, the logic is very simple. You've just provided your strategic guidelines as presented during the past two videos. It's on a functional or divisional management responsible for sales channel to create a list of 40 to 50 fuel stations with associated assumed individual capexes, meaning for each station, allocated throughout the next 2 or 3 years. They run the show on the ground, and it's their responsibility to find the right prospects. However, keep in mind that while the estimates or the general average numbers for other years can be used, all spending for each fuel station for the next year will be calculated in more details because those will be a subject of your more comprehensive analysis and the budget approval. You'll do the same for the stations intended for closure, for buying new plots or building fuel stations from scratch. And don't forget, when defending the individual projects at investment committees, functional or divisional managers or their representatives will have to provide even more detailed cost, scope and schedule structure, as we are going to explain within the next few chapters. Next, when we speak about the mass segment investment program, you will apply the same logic. Here, you can see that we actually are planning CapEx for new brand developments, branded fuels and non-fuel offer. Those will be items for stations that are not included in the list of stations intended for reconstruction. So, your guys who run a network will have to provide you with a list of stations where those types of investments will be applied, answering the questions regarding where, when, what, how much, and similar. The same will be with other domestic maintenance. However, instead of explaining what's intended for each station, the granularity level will target individual storages, trucks, railway wagons, your office buildings, and similar, depending on a scope manageable by the project managers. Most likely, within this category, you will be able to find a lot of initiatives without clear economic effect or even without any direct economic effects. For example, let's invest in improving our fire protection equipment, ecology-driven projects, etc. As you can guess, within other markets, you'll be able to see the same approach applied as for the domestic market. However, when we speak about your planned M&A activities, that might be tricky because at the moment of designing the pipeline, you might not know details about the upcoming prospects and spending, since those initiatives have their own specific dynamics. You can use a general CapEx estimates for that category until you are provided with more details and make the adjustments if the potential deal emerges at all. Finally, we came to other initiatives, and you might hope there would be nothing here since your total budget is already stretched. In practice, that rarely happens. There is always someone pushing his great idea, and that's okay, since sometimes people on the ground can see something that you have missed. For example, that might be small-scale projects like let's invest in a vessel to use it for selling fuels to supply other commercial vessels. Or let's expand our jet fuel business arm to airports at neighboring markets as well, etc. Or those might be projects that will require tens of millions of euros, like let's establish your own branded lube production facility, or to expand our fleet of trucks so we can supply our own customers, or let's upgrade and modernize this storing capacity, or let's incorporate chargers for electric cars all around our premium segment, fuel stations, etc. For some of those, you can tell, look, I really appreciate your idea. However, you're currently under pressure with the core business. Why don't you come back in a few years so we can consider it again? Although this does not sound nice, you'll have to do it here and there since it's not part of the strategy. Yet, you can even decide to put some of those initiatives within the pipeline saying, that's a great idea, I count on you. Go and prepare the project details and we are going to talk about that at the investment committee in few months from now. If you can prove what you have just told me, I'll be happy to find the money for it and be the first one to support you and see how to manage or reschedule other initiatives. To summarize, your final output of building a pipeline or the intake will be a list of all the potential projects or initiatives scheduled in detail for the next year, plus a rough list of projects or initiatives planned for the next 2 or 3 years ahead, all aligned with your strategy, plus maybe few more initiatives that might be outside of your initial scope or plans. Keep in mind that in practice, you'll have more initiatives that you can afford to finance. So during the year, you'll be able to decide which initiative to kill, which one to postpone, or to further optimize. And finally, those to select as the true champions.